Well, a very dispassionate good morning, good afternoon, good evening to you. We're just hanging out here, absorbing sort of an overall dispassionate, repentant mood, which automatically gives rise to transmissions of clarity, shifts of clarity, automatically. So your efforts are not wasted. It's not a linear sort of thing. So if you're looking for linear results, you won't see them. You won't see them. But one day you will feel like a shift, like you suddenly understand, like you have a broader perspective of everything. And you just say, wow, how'd I get there? It's all these little efforts get you there. Now, we're at the 21st of December, 2013. Very momentous day. It is the winter solstice, the shortest day of the year. And right on cue, I was given a dream that showed me what's taking place in the world. It's not good. It's not good. And it dovetails exactly with what I've been trying to do in this world, which is to lead people, minds, spirit, to a broader, more dispassionate viewpoint of the entire situation, to take the aggression out of the situation, acknowledging the seeming conflict in the world, of course. But how to get past that? How to get past that without, denying the fact that there is this enormous aggression coming into the world? There is. There are super aggressive minds that have incarnated upon this planet. Well, of course, nothing incarnates, but they think they have incarnated. They believe they have incarnated. They believe that they're in these bodies. Again, of course, no one's in a body. A spirit does not incarnate in flesh. I know it, in spite of the key Christian doctrine that God became flesh. That's not true. Spirit cannot become flesh. That is a whimsical desire of whim. Whim saying, oh yeah, we can. There's a way to make spirit flesh. No, there's not. But I know a lot of people believe that, and that's fine. That's where they're at right now. Everybody can still discipline the mind towards the ultimate truth. Wherever they are, they just have to work with what they have. And beyond everything else, a loving, forgiving, dispassionate attitude. Jesus taught that tremendously well. Forgive your brother, okay? Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. That is super important. That's dispassionate attitude. So if you disagree with somebody, just say, you know what? I need to keep on clarifying my own mind. Let me get rid of my confusion, all right? And then we'll see where we stand. So what I saw in the dream was very bad. I was standing on this, like an aircraft carrier or some platform above the ocean, like we're on an aircraft carrier in the ocean. And there were these two parties, and they were both very aggressive and had been in conflict, severe conflict with one another. And I was trying to, there was an attempt to mediate the dispute, all right? And to prevent it from going into, you know, all-out conflict. And I was observing this and wishing and desiring that the mediation take place. And then suddenly, the one on the left, okay, there's one party on the right and one party on the left. Suddenly, the party on the left took a run at the one on the right. They were both standing, we're all standing there, and suddenly lunged for them. And grabbed them and they both and pushed them off the aircraft carrier into the ocean, the choppy, stormy ocean, really. And then there was a furious fight taking place, and the one on the left was stronger and was holding this other one on the right down underwater and drowned them. And I was saying, oh my gosh, you know, I was talking to people. I said, hey, we need to jump in and save this. This person is being drowned. The one on the right is being drowned. And nobody was doing anything. And I realized, hey, if I jump in there, I'm going to be drowned myself. I'm not going to be able to stop it. So that was a very sobering dream. And it's obvious what's going on to me. Fits exactly in with what the world, what's taking place. There is a very aggressive mindset in the world that is intent on dominating and worshiping idols, the idol of whim, and it wants to get rid of all aspiration to turn away from the idols of whim. Okay, it believes that by dominating and controlling, that's its salvation. Okay, which is whimsical, but it's very much locked into that mindset. And they're super aggressive, and there's no question, look on the internet, you can read these comments, you know, it's like somebody stands up and says, you know what, I think we need to back off and this and let us maintain our, you know, and the comments are like hyper aggressive. You can tell the attitude of a mind, how aggressive it is, easily. If you're dispassionate, it's easy to tell. So there is this, you know, hyper aggressive attitude in the world right now. Now, the right, for instance, the evangelicals, they call them, quote unquote, the evangelical right, et cetera, et cetera. The fact is they're also aggressive. They have been aggressive, and they've been aggressive in pushing their own sort of passionate viewpoint of how they see things on people. Okay. But they're not as strong as they used to be, and this other group on the left is stronger. That's what I saw. And there's going to be this conflict. Now, I saw that the right, the ones on the right, were at least had a willingness to mediate this thing. Okay? It was the ones on the left that had no interest whatsoever to mediate this at all. None. All out attack, all out aggression, full-scale aggression, full-scale dominance. So this is something I've known my whole life that's coming, is the end times. And I've been trying, my life has been dedicated to trying to lead the overall mindset of the world towards a dispassionate, greater perspective and say, you know, let's all calm down. Keep on your disciplining your mind, turning your mind towards the highest truth on every single day, and it'll change. If you do that, you'll find what you thought was true yesterday has now, you see it in a different light, and you say, oh my gosh, that was kind of a little bit off, and now I'm a little bit clearer about it. And so you have to be very forgiving of one another, because perspectives shift and change. I'm not locking people into perspectives. There is an ultimate perspective. There is an ultimate opinion about reality, but even that opinion is ultimately dropped, as seen as no longer useful. Once it's had its usefulness in solving the continuity issue, it's no longer useful. But there's a lifetime of studying Christian doctrine and being in a Christian society, and the Protestant and various denominations and the Catholic and all of that. I understand, you know, what's going on there very well. And there's a lot of stuff that still has to be worked through. There's a lot of reification, a lot of idolatry, a lot of trouble, but people are trying. They're trying. But not enough. You know, that's the problem. It's kind of like they started, you know, patting themselves on the back, and that's where the problem came in. You have to be... have a spirit of humility, humbleness, and repentance in order to continually work through these things and recognize your mistakes, because there are a great many mistakes being made. That's a mixture of truth and whim, kind of a mixture of it, which is whim, right? What does whim do except try to mix truth and lies? That's what it does. So this mixture of truth and lies is whim, and you can't say, well, we got it partially true. That's whim. So you have to keep on keeping on. It's like school. You start in kindergarten, you go up through graduate school. Or if you're really smart, at some point you say, none of this is even necessary. And I just need to go directly to, you know, postgraduate school. But most of us, go up through, well, actually those who do that have already done a lot of work, actually. So everybody has to do the work. So you start out in kindergarten, and you gradually, you know, you start seeing through, you know, all this myth and mythology and stories we've told, and all these half-truths of whim, and you say, wow. And just have to keep working at it. And eventually then you get more and more dispassionate and you're not inclined to conflict and to get involved in aggressive situations. You back away from all of that, which is why I say that the return of Jesus is really a backing away from the aggression in the world that's going to take place. But a lot of religious people are still in an aggressive mode where they're defending their mistakes. You see, they're defending their mistakes, which is not good. That's not a repentant attitude. A repentant attitude should be, God, I know that I don't have it yet, and so let me not be totally aggressively dogmatic. I'm not going to be stupidly open-minded, but let me work today on trying to, bring some light, open up the situation to some more clarity today. I know that I'm not quite right yet. Maybe I'm close, maybe I'm not, I don't know, but I'm not there yet, so let me work on it today in a very repentant, humble attitude. That's what has to be done. You cannot be, passionately, aggressively dogmatic. And even if you think others are, it doesn't matter. You have to remain in that mood of repentance. That is what succeeds. Because then you're able to recognize a mistake and say, good, 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 good. Like when I recognize a mistake, which I do every day, many mistakes, I'm like very happy. I say, that's wonderful. That's tremendous. Thank you so much. I see, wow, what a huge mistake I've been making. That's what could be better, right? What could be better in a day to recognize that you've been making a huge mistake all along? And you say, thank you, thank you, thank you. That's the attitude. So when you have that attitude, you're not interested aggressively and dogmatically attacking others to the point of trying to beat them down, so to speak. You can point out the mistakes that you have recognized and share that with the world, but then just let it be. You cannot force the issue. So, unfortunately, in the world there are many who want to force the issues, and they will come into conflict. And what the problem is that the religious people of the world, they got kind of lazy. And when you get lazy, you become dogmatic. And they didn't think, they thought, hey, we don't see any real strong opposition, we can get lazy. They didn't expect what has happened. They got caught kind of unawares. They didn't realize the intensity of it. And, really, how could anybody really truly understand the intensity of what's happened? I mean, Krishnamurti warned about this back in the 1950s, okay? Came across a book in a library of his in 1975 or something, and read it, and right there it said, look, there's going to be many minds, very secular materialistic minds, who are going to come into this world, and they're going to be super arrogant and spiritually proud and unbending and unyielding, thinking that their way is the best, and they're going to subjugate the planet. He said that, Krishnamurti, a fairly substantial teacher. He's absolutely right, and he said, you better get ready for it, because it's going to be more than you expect, and he's totally right about that. It's been more than we expected. So again, humility will say, wow, the arrogance of these people in the world now is more than we expected, and so we're in trouble. And that's why, for me, I've been, every single day is like an emergency, a crisis. It's been that way my whole life. I knew this time is coming. And it's here. And now we're going into 2:14, after this date, 21st of December, you can expect a sudden acts of aggression in this world. Sudden acts of aggression, okay? You can expect it. Because the arrogance and aggression, they always eventually act. People almost always act on that. They have that high level of aggressiveness and spiritual blindness and pride and dogmaticism. It's going to be projected, and it's going to find a target. They're looking who to target, okay? So, that's likely to happen. It's likely to happen suddenly. like Jesus said, when they say peace, 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 look out. That's when the trouble will come. Because the hyper-aggressive ones, they don't want peace. They want victory. Okay, they don't want a mediation, which means they have to be looking at their mistakes. They don't think they're making any mistakes. And so peace is the last thing they want. So they may pretend to be going along, yeah, peace, okay. But meanwhile, they're preparing for aggression. That's what I saw in the dream, sudden aggression, very severe and terrible. And it was just very tough to take, because I wanted to try and stop it, you know, do something, and can't really do anything about it. And certainly the left and the right are locking horns. And again, the right is, you know, they're a little less aggressive, actually, than the left. It's the left that actually is the one that's going to be the aggressor. But the right is still quite aggressive and unrepentant, and they have a lot of work that they need to do also. I mean, let's face it, the religious people in this world have a lot of work to do still. A lot, a whole lot. But it's doable. And there's been a big attempt to try and calm the world situation down, a big attempt, but there's a likelihood that there's going to be this aggression, which is why I say relocation is a very strong possibility, like the Tibetans did, relocated out of Tibet, out of their homeland, you know, into India, when acts of aggression, you know, came upon them. Now they got out of the way, you know, a lot of them smart. Very smart. A lot of dispassion there. Not everywhere, not entirely, but there's a lot of wisdom, a lot of dispassion that came from a lot of spiritual aspiration in Tibet. So they've, you know, they relocated temporarily, they hope. Who knows? But same thing with the world in general, is that when this super aggressive conflict comes upon the world, you know, those people of dispassion will just say, hey, you know, time to relocate. So, continuing on. Will the relocation, I don't know exactly. I haven't gotten any details or anything like that. I probably don't want them at this point. We'll just have to every day remain in a humble, repentant mood. Correct your mistakes. Recognize your mistakes. Recognizing mistakes is the first step to correction, actually. When you recognize it, you don't have to do anything except recognize them. Just recognize them. Just say, okay, I see that. Not intellectually, but you just say, wow. You know, you feel like, holy cow, that's really a whopper of a mistake. Because it's all whim. Whim is nothing but a mistake. It's just complete capriciousness of arrogating that reality is now whimsical, you know. That's just a complete arrogation, which is nothing. It's nothing. But being around dispassionate minds is the greatest blessing of all. That's the one thing that I wish that I, you know, I've not yet had the pleasure of that. And for me, I'm not dispassionate enough yet to be around physically. No, not there yet. Remember, intellectualism is still very passionate, right? Very much so. That's not dispassionate at all. You have to overcome that passion of the intellect also. Or you simply, because all truth is self-evident. All truth is entirely self-evident, 100% self-evident. And that is the thing that, you know, obviously intellectual efforts are not accepting that it's self-evident. They say, I need to do something intellectually in order for truth to be true. That's whim also. Do you see these great dispassionate ones who don't seem, there nothing seems to be going on in their mind at all, intellectually, nothing, because they're just directly aware of truth is completely self-evident. Truth is entirely self-evident, entirely. So there's nothing to force on anyone. It's just to help them. He says, no, you have to seek for it. It's been lost until you fell away from it. You need to find it. You know, this crazy stuff. Again, how can you fall out of pure spaciousness? Where are you falling to? Is there some place you're falling to? So in that dream, we were like in spaciousness, up on this aircraft carrier, like but sitting up in the sky, kind of space. And this aggression pushed the two combatants down into the ocean underneath the waves, where you feel there's no spaciousness, right? And pushing, drowning means to lose track of spaciousness. That's what it means. So this aggressive mindset in this world wants you to lose track of the goal. And worship whim, which is a concatenation or a chain, like a mind getting like a chain of confusion, a chain of confusion about spaciousness, about God, about the super matrix, confusion about it, whimsicality about it, which leads to trying to place objects as primary. Object is primary, which is secular materialism, which is the new age religion of this planet. Secular materialism, make a dystopian future of worshiping things and people and celebrities and stuff, thingness. Okay, that's the opposite direction that we're supposed to be going in. So, you know, before you say, well, that can never happen, you know, the Tibetan culture was, a lot of very great teachers came to Tibet, fleeing conflicts in India, various places. It was a very protected place up in the Himalayan mountains there. And a lot of great teaching took place there, and aspiration and clarifications. So you'd think that if any place in the world would be protected, it would be that place. But look what happened. It was not physically protected. They had to relocate, which is shocking, right? So just because you think, well, we're very dispassionate and clear, doesn't mean that this world is going to be that way. Doesn't mean you may have to relocate. Doesn't mean you can stop others from whimsy. You can't. How can you stop spirit from being whimsical? You cannot. It's impossible. You can't force spirit to refrain from being whimsical. They have to, experience how distasteful it is. So they finally say, you know what, I've had enough of this. So there's no other way. So we may have to relocate. Is there some magical panacea we can, sprinkle pixie dust around the world and everybody says, oh, okay. No, it generally doesn't work that way. And it's very clear to me that these mindsets, these arrogant mindsets in the world now, are not interested in checking out their mistakes. They're only interested in projecting their mistakes out onto others and aggressively attacking those mistakes out there. Okay? And what they feel is they're supposed to be to dominate. And of course, in this world, religion has dominated to a large extent for a long time. So they want to exterminate religion, religious aspiration, which is really a spiritual aspiration, each individual, right? It's just a reflection of spiritual aspiration. They want to exterminate it because they want to dominate this planet. They feel that domination proves they're not making any mistakes. It proves it. So that's their proof. That's their evidence. And you've seen how that goes in secular materialistic agendas. They become very aggressive. Very aggressive. And they think nothing of wiping out those that they project their mistakes on others and then attack them there. And they think they wipe out others and they think, all mistakes gone. Mistake-free world. Now, all the ones that were mistaken are gone. Problem is, they still have mistakes and they keep projecting it. And so they start cannibalizing each other. So it wasn't pointed out in the dream exactly what steps are going to be taken. I had to first process the fact, like, wow, couldn't do anything about it. It was a big, big failure, unfortunately. I wanted to use music as a middle ground, okay? So that was my thing. I thought I could do that because I'm very musical, and I can produce very beautiful music if I dedicated my life to it. But in trying to do this, I found the music that these people, the very aggressive people in this world, the dominant aggressive types in this world, they're using music to pump up their projections and aggression, you see. And they're not in it. They spit with disdain on the beautiful music, that spacious, beautiful spacious music that's got, you know, slow tempo, very little instrumentation, beautiful, heartfelt, you know, conveyances, plenty of space, you know, feeling of space. Now everything's compressed, and there's a million, you know, electronic stuff, and all this stuff that is just like this massive amount of stuff in there, and tempo, you know, and all this kind of stuff, and they're using it that way. And I thought I could, you know, try and turn people towards but it didn't happen. It didn't happen. Big, huge disappointment. It wasn't supported. I was told it would be supported on a huge scale. No support ever showed up. Very interesting. Eventually that will have to be cleared up. What happened? The music got very heavy, very leaden, and just, you know, obviously, you can tell where the world's heading listening to the music that people are listening to. It's obvious. That's a, you know, dead giveaway what's going on. You know, just severe aggression is being expressed, and the music then creates a feedback loop where it augments the aggression. So that didn't work. They're not interested in that. Again, when you're interested in dominance, they say, look, first, that they're saying, first we're going to dominate and then we'll get to other stuff. And music is not as powerful as I had hoped. And so I mean, it was worth a try, but it, you know, it didn't work. You cannot have industries in the hands of these aggressive dominants, you know, but they are. You cannot allow culture to get into the hands of these, this mindset, but it has. It was a lesson learned. But how do you stop it, you know? Failure. I mean, the world failed to stop this. You see, if you have a music that everybody likes, you at least, your argument, you can say, well, at least we agree on one thing. We kind of have, you know, we like both like this, the same music or something. And you say, okay, you know, let's, and it acts kind of as a buffer, you know, to people to at least respect one another. Say, hey, you know, if you like that music, you can't be all bad. Because I really love it too. So, you know, you can't be all bad. So, it, you know, it should act in that way. That's how I feel. That was the 60s. We tried to bring this music in that was, you know, light and spacious and to people, you know, let's have a common denominator, which was music back then. Music was the common denominator. And we were at least kind to one another because we listened to similar music. And then everything started getting very, very fragmented and they're going off in different directions. I couldn't hold it together. I wanted to say, no, let's all stick to this genre because it's spacious and it's beautiful. Let's at least say we enjoy this. Couldn't do it. I remember Brian Wilson of the Beach Boys was trying to do a similar thing, and, you know, he just tore him to pieces because he couldn't make music beautiful enough that the people would all say, hey, agree, yeah, this is really beautiful. We're going to all listen to this and at least have common touchstone. He kept trying to make more and more beautiful songs and taking drugs to try and, you know, stimulate his creativity and all this kind of stuff. And it just like wiped him out. I remember that. It really had brought me down to a severe extent because I was trying to do the same thing. It was just like, wow, the music, like, he just collapsing, kind of going off into this esoteric, you know, just couldn't quite, you know, bring it together. And the music just sort of been on in severe decline, drastic decline, as these robotic, reptoid, dominant, you know, mindsets come into the world that with extreme passion to dominate and project their mistakes, etc. They bring their own music with them, of course, and they, you know, spit on the other stuff. So, you know, failure, huge mistake. I still don't quite understand, you know. That's a bitter pill to swallow because I gave it, you know, 100% effort here. Came in the world to try and just do everything possible and end up just being the complete disaster. And it got absolutely nowhere. Just utterly, you know, trampled underfoot. And I was misled in incredible ways. It was just amazing. I had this dream where I saw these two people, young man and woman, singing together. And their harmony was like the best thing I've ever heard by times 100, you know. It was better than anything I've ever heard in this world, way better. And I said, you know what, if you could come into the world and sing like that, that people are just going to lay down their arms, you know, lay down their aggression and just say, wow, let's just listen to this. And I said, let me be a part of that. So I put all out effort to try and develop some way to be part of that and help that happen. Never happened. I got a lot of encouragement initially. It never, ever happened. So, you know, this severely misled. Where did that singing come? Where did those two people in my dream come from? And that I heard them singing. You know, they're just walking through this park and they were just singing together. And it was just completely celestial. I can't even. And they actually asked me, do you want to sing with us? And I said, I'll try. And so then I started training for singing, threw my whole life into singing and playing musical accompaniment. And I spent a fortune trying to get ready. I said that I thought there was going to be this great band coming into the world that would be so awesome. People would just have to stop and listen, you know? That was the goal. That was my goal. And I got all the support for it, and yet it never, ever happened. I was left holding the bill for everything. Which is, you know, devastated my life, actually, financially. You know, it's just, and nothing ever happened. So, on the subtle levels, all this in ideas was there, the reinforcement, the planning, everything. I did everything. I had a whole recording studio, everything. Music, I was all ready to push this out into the world with a recording studio, accommodations, everything. Never showed up. They never showed up, those two singers. They never showed up. So who were those two singers is the question. They really, you know, somehow that's going to have to be, you know, resolved because, you know, you don't come to somebody and sing like and give such incredible beauty to somebody and then sort of promise them, hey, yeah, you're going to sing with us, and then never show up because you're going to inspire somebody to prepare for it, of course. So it was very, very problematical. Thing to do, actually. Ruinous. That's one of the best, like the uber mystery, you know, the uber mystery. Who are those singers? Meister singers, you know, I'm telling you. I practiced for the last 20 years or so, how long? It's been a long time. To try and be able to handle singing with them, you know, harmony and super flexibility and all this kind of stuff. Never showed up. Will they show up? I don't know. At this point, I don't really. It's not something I really pay much attention to because it's just like, but I've left at the altar, you know, 1,000 times over, and so I don't have any indication they ever will show up. Who they were, I don't know. I just assumed, you know, it was two great spiritual masters being able to sing like that. But could have been just two extremely egotistical people. It's possible that it's possible to sing extremely well like that without being, you know, truly liberated from delusion. I imagine it is possible. Yeah. Because if I could get to a point where I could capable of singing with them, which I pretty much have, and I'm not liberated. So it's possible, right? It is possible. These were just two, you know, supremely musically talented people, but they were still arrogant and desirous of acquiring, you know, fame for themselves. They weren't really liberated from delusion. That is possible. That is possible. You know, if that's so, wow, what a extremely misleading thing. Extraordinarily misleading. That's why I tell you music is very dangerous. Because if you can hear something that's so wonderful, you think this must be it. This must be it. So I always say keep music very simple, very basic, and keep it, don't make it sophisticated, and keep it always in line with spiritual aspiration. And don't go into pop singing, pop music, music for art's sake. It's a very dangerous road. Very dangerous road. You can really get misled to an extreme extent that way. Maybe the worst way possible is that way. Is if you just hear some truly celestial singing and music and you just think, wow, this is it. And you'll do anything to help that out, to support it. You'll do anything. And you can go off track so badly that way and end up in a very bad situation. Because, of course, the artists, they expect you to do everything for them. And, you know, that's not their problem. You do all the work for them to support them. And here come, you know, they're the divas. You know, the diva and the divas. And you're supposed to get all the M&Ms just right for them. You know, you're the support crew. Yeah, that was my role. Do everything. You know, the roadie, the manager, the one that, you know, the contract. Everything has to be supportive, just so the divas could show up and sing. You know, and maybe they said, "Well, you didn't do enough." You know, they took a diva attitude. Probably, I don't know. But in some ways, that detracts people from the sober path of realization, doesn't it? Beautiful singing does detract. Now, I was only looking at it as a way to diffuse this aggression in the world, not as an ultimate panacea, no, but just to try and, it's like sports, you know, you have two leaders of countries that are angry and they both enjoy basketball or whatever it is. It's something that at least to say, you know what, you can't be that bad because you enjoy the same thing I enjoy. You know, let's, you know, ping pong diplomacy, if Nixon, you know, something that says, you know what, let's focus on our commonalities, okay? Let's focus on our commonalities instead of our differences. Yeah, oh, I love, you know, this artist or something. Yeah, I do too. Oh, this is some commonality. Let's start. It's a starting point of commonality. That's what I was looking at. I said, you know what, this singing is so awesome that people might say, you know what, I like that. You like that too? Commonality. Let's start there. So that was a lifetime of effort and came up completely empty, totally empty. So that's a bitter pill to swallow for sure. And that has to be eventually resolved. And what happened? What happened? Because it's you know, terrible what's coming. The aggression is terrible. And of course, everybody wants, you know, so many people want to do something to help it out. There's no question they want to do something to help it out. So this is just an example. But meanwhile, every day we have to recognize our mistakes. And that's a whopper of a mistake. Because it's based on compassion of trying to help. And that's not like an ultimate realization. That's kind of like, well, even if I was ultimately realized, then what do you do? How do you help? Now, that's the question that we have, right? How do we help? And it doesn't seem to be any way to help. You know, the Tibetan Buddhists could not help the Chinese to see their viewpoint, could they? They couldn't say, hey, we have commonality, let's let them, no, no. So how do you help? Maybe, you know, in A Course in Miracles it says only, that is your only responsibility here. You don't have any other. So, you know, that's a pretty strong statement, actually. Very strong statement. And I guess you have to take that at its value and say, maybe that is true. That's all you can do, is all anyone can do, is to literally accept the vision of Christ, which is what we're talking about, so which is the Holy Spirit's opinion about reality. Accept that, and then you've done your part, and that's it. And then if the Holy Spirit has something for you to do, it will, you know, enable you to do that. But fundamentally, that's your only responsibility. You don't have to try and save the world or help others, and you know, and there, except just do it for yourself. So really, the path is everything comes back to you. Everything comes back to you, and your responsibility. And you have to show others that it's possible, you know, to be responsible here. Otherwise, there's no motivation for them. You know, music lacks motivation. You know, it does. It's not strong enough. It's not strong enough to bind people together with whim. It's not strong enough because it lacks motivation. It's not grounded in realization. It's not it's not showcasing that everything is perfect. It's seeing the opinion of the Holy Spirit that everything's incredibly beautiful and perfect just as it is. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to make beautiful music. Everything is completely beautiful just as it is. This is what people really need to be aware of. Not a reification of it, which is music would be a reification of all these notes sequenced, etc., and tones and things like that. No, everything exactly as it is right now, without anything happening at all. Right now, without anything needing to happen at all, is perfect. How is it perfect? It's all perfectly abiding, equally abiding in pure spaciousness. There's equal abidance taking place. That is what is conveyed by through silence and through stillness and calmness and actually experiencing it. There's something that is transmitted that is even more powerful. So music is like a drug. It's a panacea. It's a temporary thing. And the drug is worn off in this world. And I thought I could come in and produce, you know, music and be part of that, but it started wearing off very fast, and by the time I was old enough to actually do it, the whole thing had already started to collapse. It was too late. Too late. Got to the party too late. But in seeing that collapse, I was able to say, whoa, what's going on? And then make adjustments and get on the right path here. So it actually worked out for my benefit, but it was very severe way to go. It's like running, trying to climb, you know, uphill battle. Those were part of the 60s. It did, you know, was part of that whole thing. Music, the 60s, 70s. You know, they're still writing that thing, and that was their thing, but it didn't really work. They're going to be, you know, disappointed at some point, you know, for sure. They're going to be like, oh my God, all this effort I made to bring peace to the world and it didn't work, you know, it's just like blow their minds. It's not good. So maybe I can help the musicians, you know, having been part of that tradition for a long time, deal with this shock, you know, just depression probably. I mean, like, whoa, we didn't do it. We didn't bring peace to the world. All these positive people, you know, who have been trying to bring peace to the world, they're going to be shocked. No question. They're going to need help. It's a bitter, bitter pill to swallow. Very bitter pill. And then you got no choice. You got to eventually go on to this non-dual perspective. You know, go towards that. And keep it really simple. And you got to basically drop music. You know, you can't keep on thinking that this is, you know, everybody dance. Come on, let's be happy. Let's dance. You got to go past that. bitter pill to swallow for sure. And so here's the times now. We're at the times. Gonna be a lot of trouble, sudden aggression, and possibly, hopefully, I get to hobnob with dispassionate minds. And hopefully, I get to do that. Now that's on my agenda. That's next on my agenda, is to actually hang out with dispassionate minds that see the perfection, the ultimate fact of immediate now perfection. That nothing has ever been imperfect. There's nothing that needs to be fixed at all. Nothing needs to be fixed. There is no problem at all. That's a fact. There are those who want to create a problem, but it's just fantasy. There isn't any problem. It's a continuity issue, pragmatic issue, but that's it. So for me, I want to at least hobnob with some. I hope I've got to the position where that's possible, to appreciate it. And we'll see what happens as far as this aggression goes and what to do about it. That's on our agenda now. I mean, aggression is coming. It's coming. You build up enough steam, it's gonna blow a lid somewhere, right? And it's gonna blow a gasket somewhere. You overheat your car, it's going to pop a hose somewhere, guaranteed, right? If you ever overheated a car, which I have many times actually, it's gonna blow a radiator. You know, it's gonna blow a radiator. Pop a hose. The engine's gonna quit on you. So that's coming. That's coming. That's coming very quickly. So wherever you are, just keep working on trying to be more dispassionate, more spacious, simpler. Keep it simple, easy and simple. Just say, where I'm at right now, I need to be easy and simple. Very easy, very simple, very dispassionate. Don't worship idols. All idols are just equally appearing as decorations in pure spaciousness, right? So, are there some decorations that are more in pure spaciousness than others? No, there's not. Same, 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 same. Just keeps it same, 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 sameness. It's all sameness. It's all sameness. And know that when you're struggling, you're in the same boat as everyone else. We're all struggling with this, actually. There are a few that have gone farther than we have, for sure. There's no question about that. And there's some that have gone all the way in pure realization, absolutely. Or pure non-realization, or purely understanding, accepting that no realization is necessary. Everything as it is self-realized, is realized by pure spaciousness, always has been. There's never been any falling away from that, ever. Never will be. So this whole idea of no. We need to accept that no realization is necessary for anything. Everything is perfect, perfectly realized, or beyond that, not even needing to be realized, but we can say everything is perfectly realized as the intermediate step, absolutely, without us doing anything. It's our belief that we had to do something for this to be true, which is the problem. So there are some that who've got this, and they're a little further along than we are, and some who completely, you know, gotten it, and they're even, you know, they're at the really, really helpful. So hopefully we can spend time with those who have, you know, are a little further along with us than we are, which is, it's helpful. It's very helpful. It's not easy, but it's helpful, because you don't think they're helping you, but actually they are, because they're kind of relaxing your effort, saying, calm down, you know, you're okay, everything's okay, everything's perfectly okay. In reality, everything's perfectly okay. We're just misperceiving it all. So we'll see who shows up, who we hobnob with. Hopefully that's the next step here as we go now into this super, super, super time here. And it can be very disillusioning time. I mean, the dismay of the world, you know, I felt there, the dismay that this aggression took place was, I was dismayed, you know, it was just like, and everybody was like shocked, they couldn't do anything about it. It's like, wow. A lot of idealistic people have been trying to bring peace to the world, you know, not understanding that it starts with realization that everything is already at perfect peace. There's nothing that is not peaceful already. It's true. Even the most intense aggression is abiding in the pure, pure peacefulness of reality at all times. But this is an advanced sort of recognition that can happen. You know, it can dawn. It will dawn on everyone eventually. You just have to keep going. So keep cultivating, you know, the smooth, same evenness. Keep it simple and easy. Just take the next step, simple and easy. All right? Very great. That's it for this video.